Heads up! Heads up! Heads up! It's another one, another one, and another one. Why you all in my ear talking a whole...
Welcome back to another episode of Topic Thunder. If you're wondering why I may not sound super thrilled, we have a special guest today. We introduced him. We had an awesome introduction, and we were like 20 minutes into a trade talk, and I was not recording the episode. I feel like such a dick and an asshole. And I apologize to Dan. I apologize to Cone.
You're fine.
You're
good, tyranny.
A lot of good talk. That was like really great, and no one's ever going to hear it. And I'm very
We're still here. We're going to run it back.
We're gonna re-uncork it. They'll hear it. Don't worry.
Yeah. Okay. We're good. So we are here today with Cone and with Dan Favale of Bleacher Report. Sorry, Dylan, but it just feels like doing the whole intro thing again feels like very, I don't know, it doesn't feel right. So we are very happy to have Dan Favale on, and we're welcoming him back. And so I don't know if I want to do the same intro again, where it's like, Dan, talk about your all of your trades again. But I do want to kind of get back into the ones we were talking about before we figure this out. So if you have not gone to Bleacher Report yet and seen Dan's article, it was all 30 teams, trade targets for every one of them. So if you're like, who's on my team that I need to get, that's where you go. And for ours, the Thunder, there was five players, and we were kind of talking about a couple of them there at the beginning. That Dan, I kind of want to ask you again, just how you see these players on this team, like what you're thinking about all of them. We mentioned so there's obviously all the Thunder fans out there want the big splash. We want the Lauri Markkanens, we want the Mikal Bridges, but we know that the Thunder's mantra is not to do that. Sam Presti does not just give up all of the picks. He's going to keep them until the right opportunity, which doesn't feel right now for that big splash. And so some of these guys that you've got on here kind of show that, which is the more realistic expectations for this team. And so you've got not the big guys like Markkanen, but other guys in that area of size and physicality, like Isaiah Stewart, Robert Williams for next year, and John Collins. And so I wanted to just throw that to you and think about like what do you think for those guys? Like, what are some potential trade packages that you see for the Thunder moving out for any of them?
Yeah, I think John Collins is the easiest one because, as you mentioned, they're not gonna. I'd be shocked if they like had this huge splash. But you have the Davis Bertans money that, yeah, you could technically have him on the books if you want him next season. But someone who actually plays is gonna have more value. John Collins is someone who can give you some rebounding. He's been playing a lot better over recent weeks, and I think people confuse his availability with Utah not liking him. Why would we want him? Versus, no, the Jazz just need to make sure they're opening up enough minutes for Walker Kessler and Taylor Hendricks and Lauri Markkanen, who it seems like they're going to keep. Mm-hmm. And so if you can have his money as someone who comes in, maybe helps you, maybe he doesn't, but who will have more value this offseason than Davis Bertans if he were to guarantee his contract, I think goes a long way. And it doesn't cost you a first-round pick. RW3 is more complicated because that probably costs you, like, that would be least favorable language, or maybe it's one of the bad first round picks that you have, or does Portland want a flyer on like an Usman Jang or even a Trey Mann? But like, to have him on your roster for next season with Chet as someone who's, RW3 is a pretty good passer out of the short role. He can rebound, he can play physical, he can be switchable, but he also can't play a ton of minutes and he's an injury risk, which is why the Thunder are almost kind of the perfect situation for him. But you have to have the foresight to say, well, we're kind of thinking ahead to next year now, and this isn't going to help us during the playoffs. The flip side of that is Thunder already really good. There's a chance, like, if you say right now the Thunder come out of the West, they're good enough to do that, even if you're not prepared to predict it. And so I could see them taking a longer like view with that. And there's Isaiah Stewart, who, as Cone and I had mentioned before, neither one of us was like huge fans of him.
Yeah, not huge.
Matching his salary is a little difficult following the extension, but he is a try-hard. We haven't seen the full extent of what he can do at the basket or as a rebounder because he's played a lot of four for Detroit this season. But when you have Chet, who's shooting threes, as opposed to Jalen Duren, you can play those two together more easily, or just use Isaiah Stewart as kind of a change of physiology type backup big to Jay Will. So I don't love that one just because he has 4 years left on his deal and it's like, it's fine value, but he's not going to be someone who has premier value. But in terms of filling a need and having like the eighth or ninth best player on your roster who could work in the playoffs, he would be interesting. But it feels like those are the scales of moves where we're not talking about the Thunder getting another top 25 guy. It's, can this player be on the floor for us in the playoffs and be in the top eight or nine of our rotation?
Yeah. But we mentioned a little bit earlier too, with the John Collins thing, like you mentioned, it's not that Utah doesn't want him. Like, Collins has been really good for them. They moved him to playing a lot more five in their lineup. They've been starting him a lot more. And when he's been playing like that, he's been really good. And Utah has been thriving as of late. You know, they've come down to earth a little bit since that ridiculous win streak that they're on a little bit ago, but they've still been really good so far this season, especially relative to expectations. And, you know, you get money that's going forward. You have a guy that can fill up a large salary slot in case you do eventually decide, hey, we want to make a big deal, use some of these first round picks. You've still got a guy who's making about like $30 million-ish. You throw in some first round picks, probably some other salary filler if you're going for one of the top name guys, and then you get that deal done. Collins could definitely help us right now. It feels like a lot of money, and I'm sure a lot of Thunder fans would say, oh, why are we going for a guy that's making that much? But I think eventually it would make a lot of sense to people, especially because he would help us as of right now, especially if you want to keep that stretchability. A lot of Thunder fans are talking about like, oh, we need like a Drummond, a guy who can go get rebounds. When for me, I want someone who can, you know, yeah, exactly. I see you shaking your head. No, no to me. Like, I put out a tweet not too long ago that I was like, who would you want as a Thunder fan for us to trade for? And I got way too many Andre Drummond replies. It made me really sad. Because I don't want like a big plodding big who's only going to grab rebounds and not stretch the floor, can't do anything with the ball in their hands. We've all seen that one clip of Drummond trying to ISO back when he was on the Cavs and threw up the worst layup anyone's ever seen. Like, I don't want stuff like that. So, you know, John Collins definitely works. Robert Williams, like you mentioned, good passing on the short roll. Was utilized really well in that Boston offense. He can play the five and alongside Chet, or he can play the five solo. Of course, you know, goes till next year and we don't have him for this season. But I love that archetype of player long term. We also talked about Nick Claxton the first time, and he's another guy that kind of fills that role. If we're going to get a big that doesn't really shoot that much, I want someone who at the very least is young, athletic, can defend at a high level and do way more than just like grab rebounds. So Claxton is a guy I would love. You know, we would have to sign him again after this offseason because he's a restricted free agent. But I mean, hey, you know, even if you have to pay him a lot, could be a guy that fits a salary spot going forward again for that trade while also being really productive in the now. And hey, who knows? Maybe you don't have to go out there and trade him if he's really good next to Chet. And, you know, the defense between Chet, him, Dort, Shea, J-Dub out there, like that type of lineup, it's ridiculous. Like, I don't know how you score consistently against those guys. A lot of switchability on that team too. So yeah, those guys all make sense to me. Again, I way prefer your trade targets than some of the ones Thunder fans are throwing out there. Like, again, in Andre Drummond, they're like, we need rebounding and not really thinking about how it fits into nothing the else. Scheme of what this team does. Right. Exactly. Like, it doesn't make sense.
I will say I don't like him for the Thunder either. But like what allows him to be good in Chicago is because he has all those like really hyperactive defenders in front of him, which is what he hasn't had a lot of his other stops. And so the Thunder do have that. So there's a chance that he isn't as big of a defensive liability in the playoffs, but I would be with you in the sense that like, if that's the move, like I'm would rather see Jay Will on the floor at any given point than Andre Drummond. I do like that you're okay with Nick Claxton being on this team because I've gone back and forth, not just because of the contract. Like you said, he's young, just pay him. And because he's an unrestricted free agent, there will be interest. But like we've seen, the big man market is weird. It's like everyone's talking about Isaiah Hartenstein is going to get paid. And it's, will he? Like these non-star bigs just don't get huge deals. But he's a little bit like you would want more heft or someone like maybe more brawn. But he even has some ball skills. You mentioned Andre Drummond doesn't have that. Like Nick Claxton can make dribbles and then decisions from there. And just his switchability on defense. And he's a really good rebounder for someone who is so slight. So that would be, for me anyway, from my perspective, that'd be like nice outside the box thinking from OKC where it's, hey, we're not afraid to just go out and get this guy who's going to become a free agent. And yeah, John Collins, you mentioned him or whatever Nick Claxton makes. Now's the time to kind of have those sort of stopgap expensive guys on your roster because you're not dealing with a Josh Giddey, a J-Dub, a Chet Holmgren extension kicking in. Like you have a couple of years before that becomes an issue. And so utilize that type of flexibility.
Yeah. And it's interesting too, like we talked about with Oklahoma City specifically, because they never make those big time splashes. Yet we have so many first round picks that are typical of a team that's trying to make a splash. Like, we've got all these assets. I believe we've got three first round picks in 2024, which is not supposed to be a great draft. So I don't see us bringing in three rookies next season with everyone we're already struggling to get minutes to. Yeah, like, or even the roster space. Like, I don't. So to me, that's one of the most interesting things is, you know, maybe it's an offseason trade, but coming up to the deadline, if there's a chance to trade these picks, which, you know, it's the Rockets pick, that might be a lottery pick, the Jazz pick, which might also be right around there. Like, we have pretty good picks to go out there and deal. So do we deal them now? And then, you know, they've got a lot of value going forward. Do we wait until the offseason and then make something happen at some point? Because we're reaching the point where it's no longer just future picks. It's picks right now. So what are we going to do with them? You know, what's the game plan? Maybe it is wait until the draft and see what you can do. Maybe you like a player a lot. You package some of them to trade up. I don't really know. But because the Thunder don't really make splashes but have the assets to do so, we're in this weird limbo where it's like, what is going to happen? Like, what are they actually going to do?
Yeah, it's looking back at sort of like similar timelines for the Thunder, I think a lot of people now are thinking of the sort of 2011, 2012, maybe 2013 Thunder, where they were and sort of up and coming, and where they were at the time and the trades they made, they did what we're kind of expecting right now. They didn't make a lot of splash. The one that I think a lot of people are reflecting on is the Kendrick Perkins trade, because that was around the same time. And looking back, that was not a good trade, because I think, like, you know, hindsight with the small ball era, that wasn't great. But that's, I think that's the, people are sort of using that and comparing it to now and being like, well, we were kind of, you know, with Westbrook and Durant and Harden, we were still like growing in that trio. And then we got that Perkins that was supposed to be the anchor to that team. And so I think that's so worth, at least for myself as more of a casual Thunder fan, like that's where the idea of like just bringing in this piece to fit defensively around this team comes in. But kind of going back to one of the trades you mentioned with Robert Williams. So we had talked to a couple of other members of our podcast about what trades they want to see, and they couldn't be on tonight to mention them. So I kind of pulled some together, and the one that kind of is somewhat related to what you were thinking, Dan, but maybe a little bit off kilter, is with the Trailblazers. Brogdon's been another one of the people kind of in trade talks. And so this was a little bit more of a splash, but I want to get your thoughts on it, because it's got Brogdon and RW3, and then the Thunder are giving back two of those first round picks this year, which we mentioned are probably want to get rid of. Second round pick, and then Davis Bertans, obviously, for the contract, Poku, and Usman Jang. And so as a Thunder fan, that looks pretty good. But like, I'm curious what you think as the value for the Thunder in that pick, or that trade, I should say.
I think the equity going back is probably close to spot on. But when you're Portland and you're going to have your own pick and Golden State's pick this year to get two more 2024 picks is probably tough, but like the Thunder could, they have the picks to like rework that. I do love the idea of Brogdon in OKC just as someone who gives you like a different level of ball handling and floor spacing in the playoffs, to where we've even kind of seen, like, you know, Josh Giddey and Lu Dort aren't necessarily assured of playing in the highest leverage moments anymore because of the way that defenses will guard them, and specifically Giddey, where we've seen a lot of stuff and like bigs are kind of on him and then roaming. You can't do that to Brogdon because of his straight line drives and then just the shooting in general. So to get someone like that in OKC, who that fits, like that's the perfect timeline of salary slot rolling, because he's an expiring contract next year. And so you make, like, even if a team doesn't necessarily want him because he's older, he's good and the contract comes off the books immediately. And so that's a really fascinating one to look at. And I love the idea. I've generally steered clear of like adding another creator type, just because you have Giddey, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, J-Dub, and then also like Cason Wallace. But Malcolm Brogdon can play in the off-guard role. He can play in the point guard role. And I think he's someone who would help them a great deal for the playoffs.
Yeah, I feel like, you know, obviously the guy we want is the big or someone who adds a little bit of size. But also, as someone who went to UVA, you know, UVA fan, got bias here. Brogdon's really good. Brogdon's been fantastic so far for Portland. Of course, won Sixth Man of the Year last year. Like you said, it would be nice to have another guaranteed guy that is going to knock down threes, can handle the ball. Because like you said, with Giddy, especially if I'm looking forward towards a potential series against some of these teams in the West, like a Minnesota. Right now, like our matchups against Minnesota have been specifically difficult because if Giddy's out there, Gobert's playing on him and just roaming. And if you let Rudy Gobert roam, that's a complete disaster. So having another guy that we could put in that we know is going to make a lot of right decisions, can pass, can dribble, you know, knock down shots consistently, it's huge. And it just gives us another weapon, another high-level three-point shooter for a team that has a bunch of them. But also that veteran experience, a guy who's, you know, been into the playoffs before. He's had a lot of success there. It would be a big addition, even though I'm sure a lot of Thunder fans would be like, oh, not another guard. I feel like just in terms of play style and fit, he does make sense. Of course, you know, would still like to add some size somehow. But if that's the deal, like, I don't mind it at all.
Mm-hmm. You mentioned Giddy and Dort. I'm glad you did, because that's obviously like a hot topic with the Thunder trades right now. So I guess actually I want to I'll hold off on Giddy for a second. I want to talk about Dort, because in your article, your number one choice for the Hawks was Lu Dort. And I thought that was interesting because it's not a player that off the cuff you're like, oh yeah, he could probably be dealt. But then you think back to it, and a lot of the closing lineups for the Thunder do not have Giddy or Dort on them. You're subbing in like Wiggins and Wallace and even Kendrick sometimes. So I was curious because you mentioned in the article that, like, you know, the Hawks are building around Jalen and Trey. And so Dort is like a defensive piece you could add to that. But I'm curious what your thoughts are on like the package back to the Thunder. Like, what would the Hawks be giving to us? Like, what is that deal sort of look like? Because I don't think we've really fleshed that out, Dort packages, especially on this podcast recently.
I think there's a couple ways it could go, and I've been a bigger proponent of this than Thunder fans were in our YouTube comments at one point when I mentioned they were not happy. DeJounte Murray's not a bad fit for this team. When you're talking about someone whose shot making is for real and will force defenses to guard him, and you want another, if you want another ball handler in the playoffs and as an asset to reroute later. So like there could be a framework there, but the other thing is just like Onyeka Okongwu would be a really good fit for this team. He's not super huge, but like that's someone who's going to add some defensive dynamism, and you could play him with Chet. You could play him independent of Chet. He's poison pilled, but like they have other salaries that can be sent out as well, where it's, are the Thunder team that's willing to take a flyer on the next 3 years of DeAndre Hunter. So I don't think you're getting a first round pick for Dort in that equation. You're viewing it more as like the Thunder want, to me, how I viewed it was the Thunder actively want to explore the DeJounte Murray route, or we're going to take a look at, there was no Clint Capella involvement here. I know that there were some national media members who really think the Thunder need Clint Capella for some reason, but like it's a Murray or an Onyeka Okongwu sort of slant there. And then you just flesh out, you know, with Murray, the money's easy. If it's Onyeka Okongwu, you figure out the other moving parts there. And Atlanta just needs, I think Trae Young's gotten better defensively, but you need someone who can actually define your perimeter defense. And that's never really been DeJounte Murray, even though he can be a good defender. He looks a lot better in a place like OKC, where there are two, three better defenders than him on the court at any given time. So that was the framework I was there. If you'll notice, Okongwu and Murray did not make my Thunder board. So it was more from the Hawks perspective. But I would be more fascinated, I think, than a lot of Thunder fans as to what DeJounte kind of looks like in OKC. But that probably then signals something pretty profoundly telltale about how they feel with Josh Giddey moving forward.
Yeah, bringing in a guy like DeJounte feels like it spells the end for what Giddey would provide here, which I'm not at all opposed to. So if that's the way that we go, then it makes sense.
Honestly, I love to hear that. I've never been like a on the court Giddey guy, and I came around a little bit last season, but I think also part of it is now because the emergence of J-Dub and how I criticized the Thunder for not getting enough value in that Bertans trade just to like get Case and Wallace. Mm. I was wrong. Like that dude's just coming in and is so plug and play and does everything you need. And your biggest gripe is like, well, I wish he would just shoot more or be more confident, and that'll come. He's such a better fit that I think it's like kind of induced, even if you're really high on Giddey. I just don't know if this is the right sort of ecosystem for him anymore because of the emergence of all these other players.
Yeah, like the vision with Giddey was the other ball handler for Shea, and now J-Dub does that way better. He's way more efficient. He fits way better next to Shea. Like, he does everything better than Giddey in that exact role that Giddey was supposed to be in. So you have that making him obsolete, like you said, with Casein Wallace, who, again, like, the only criticism people really have is, why doesn't he shoot more? Because he's one of the most efficient rookies in the league, knocks down those corner threes a lot. He has been more aggressive recently. Like last night against the Raptors, mm-hmm. there were a couple of times before he left with that shoulder injury he was dealing with that he like went ahead and just attacked straight downhill, finished through contact. He's just so poised for a rookie, which is amazing to see. And now that you have him, you've got Shea. You know, Isaiah Joe can do a little bit of things with the ball in his hands as well. Attack on closeouts, hit that little pull at midi, not quite as much as the other guys. But the Thunder are building a roster that has all these players that can handle the ball and do things with them. So Giddey, a guy that can't really shoot consistently or defenses don't respect the shot at all, it just makes him obsolete. So that's part of why if we do go out there and add another type of guard guy, I'm perfectly fine with that because I feel like there are some potential matchups where Giddey could be almost unplayable if he's still on the roster heading into the playoffs. Like, say we don't make a big deal against Minnesota in particular. Like, that's the team I think about. Even I think against, like, say the Lakers, and if we facing off against them, if they're able to put Anthony Davis on, you know, Giddey and just let him roam, that's a disaster. So mm-hmm. I love the idea of having
Aaron Gordon
exactly able to do that. Too.
Like, yeah,
yeah. So having another guard that could give us a little bit more of a dynamic offense where you can put Giddey off to the side, but you still have a ball handler in his spot. Someone again with maybe some more experience than Casein, who would be going into, and a lot of these guys would be going into their first ever playoff series. Bringing someone that's a bit more veteran experienced, I'm perfectly fine with that. So that's one of the reasons why a lot of people are like, oh, we don't need another guard, but if we bring in a guy like that, I'm perfectly fine with it.
I'm reticent to give them another guard because I refuse to cut down Isaiah Joe's minutes at all, who's one of my favorite players.
That is fair. I don't know. I'm so mad he has not yet been announced in the three-point contest. I don't think it's going to be it's going to happen. I've been campaigning for this for last year, going into this season, and they refuse to listen to me. I'm heartbroken. So
it's okay. Next year. But yeah,
Tierney, I said that last year. That's the problem.
we're just going to run it back every year. But yeah, the Giddey. Giddey minutes do feel like once J-Dub rose to stardom, he kind of eclipsed Giddey there. Mm-hmm. And so kind of going into that now in the trade thoughts, I'll leave this up in the air. I'll say my thoughts after, but on a scale of like 0 to 100%, like zero being the Thunder, keep him and then figure out what they do in the offseason, to he's 100% getting traded this trade deadline. Where is that bar for you? Like, where do you think that possibility lies?
I mean, I'd probably say I'll give it a 1% chance he gets traded like by the deadline. It's really tough when these players are good and clearly have potential. Moving them on their rookie scale deals is so weird because their numbers are generally tiny. And yes, mm-hmm. because Giddey was a higher draft pick, you are working with a slightly bigger number, but it's only $6.6 million. And so he's better than a $6.6 million player. How do you get adequate value back from him? Now, if you're opening it up to let's use DeJounte Murray as just the example here. The Hawks mm-hmm. don't want Giddey when you have Trae Young, but like if you start to open it up to third teams that rally there and you're using Giddey as part of the compensation where let's say the Spurs wanted Josh Giddey, are they willing to send stuff to Atlanta because they have that Toronto pick? They have that, I think it's a Chicago pick coming up. I could see permutations like that, but like that comes back to the discussion we opened with, which is the Thunder are, and look, we've seen they traded for Paul George. So like they have made big splashes when they've needed to, but this just doesn't feel like the moment, and their big splashes, and maybe I'm wrong, but like the actual big splash they've ever made, they don't come mid-season. And so I would think if they do anything with Josh Giddey, it would be over the offseason after kind of getting a feel for what he's looking like on an extension. And it's like, all right, well, we could pay him this, but his trade value might precipitously drop because he's not going to look as good with us as he will in a better ecosystem that's more catered to putting the ball in his hand. So I guess I would be, and I don't use this word lightly, if he gets moved to the deadline, I would be caps lock flabbergasted. And I might be happy about it, like for what it means that's coming back. But unless you do either of you guys, like that would be one of like the most un-Thunder-like moves that I could remember.
Yeah, I would be I'd be surprised. I think I was also going to say excited in the same breath because like you were saying there, but I would be really surprised if anything happened with Giddey at the deadline. It feels way more like an offseason move for us. Like you said, we don't really make those mid-season blockbusters that often. We usually make a trade of some kind, but it's never the big one. The big ones like the Paul George trade and the Melo trade and all that come in the offseason. You know, when we sent back Paul George over to LA and brought in Shea, all that stuff, it never really happens mid-season. It seems like we usually get to the offseason, evaluate, and then figure out what do we do going forward, which may be good. You know, going this year into the playoffs, say we make an addition to bolster our chances now, but we go in there and say a weakness gets exposed that we didn't really know we had before, and then now we can reevaluate, okay, we have a full offseason to plan. What do we have to do to get this team ready for next season? Because they've shown they can be one of the best teams in the West. How do we now get them to that next step where they can win a championship? So to me, that's also how I kind of feel they're probably going to operate. It would be cool if they made a big splash. You know, those don't always immediately lead to championships. Like, I can't remember the last time a massive deal at the deadline led to the team that year winning a title. Like, nothing specifically is coming to mind. I know there was, like, Marc Gasol, I think, was traded at the deadline to the Raptors back in 2019. But, you know, that's not, like, the big trade. The Kawhi one in the offseason was the big one. But, yeah, anyways, it doesn't feel very Thunder-like to make that splash right now, even though there are a lot of Thunder fans that are like, oh, we got to trade Giddy now, or even if, you know, that might be the right move, it's not something we'll do, I don't think.
I will say, and sorry to hijack this part of it, I don't know that I remember, and maybe it's just because you both have mentioned some of these guys don't have playoff, like very little or any playoff experience. They are, what are they, second in net rating on the season? I don't remember a team being this good where there's been such an appetite from the media, general NBA fans, even the Thunder fan base, like, we need to make this big move. And it's like, well, I know you've had some weird games and like the Timberwolves matchup is concerning and the Nuggets exist, but like you might, like, this team is theoretically good enough to just futz and fiddle, if anything. Mm-hmm. And so I wouldn't be I want them to do something because I do think that they have clear needs and that they just I think it's because they have the ability to do it. Like a lot of these other teams that like Milwaukee clearly need some serious upgrades, but they're working with so little, where it's like when you mention them with DeJounte Murray, it's a farce because they don't have anything to offer Atlanta for him. So I find that very ironic that just the Thunder are this good and there's an appetite from everyone. It's like, no, you gotta do more. Like,
it's this like flexibility, like you were saying, like if you have all of these picks and all of these assets, then it's like, you can just go crazy. And then that's, you know, perfect for media speculation.
Yeah, I think
Sam Presti actually ended up trading for more first round picks. Like, that's the move, is like, he's rolling
just
out some
pile it on.
He's not converting salary slots. He's converting 2024 picks into like 2029 picks at this point or something. That, like, that would be the most Sam Presti move, maybe.
That could actually happen.
Yeah. I think the combination of how young this team is, how good they are, and the draft picks, I think that kind of leads to that. I also feel like Thunder fans are also just kind of traumatized. Like having, you know, Kevin Durant, Westbrook, Harden making it to the finals as a young team and then not getting over the hump ever. I feel like a lot of Thunder fans are traumatized where they're like, we have a chance, we have to do it now. Like, we cannot waste any opportunities.
They're not wrong either, because I've actually seen the sentiment more so like nationally. It's like, why would the Thunder they're going to run the league for the next 5, 7, 10 years? It's like, it doesn't work like that. It'd be cool, but like, we just see these title windows open and shut so quickly, and it's like, who would have, like, look at the path that like Kevin Durant and James Harden have traveled over the past like 4 years, and like, how all their teams that they've been on have had a title window of maybe 2 years over the past half decade, because these things are changing so fast and furiously. And so yes, the Thunder look incredibly set up just to run the tables for the next 5, 7, 10 years, but we know better. Like, something's going to happen, and it just doesn't work like that. And so I get the sentiment of like, well, if you have a chance now, you should go for it. They're in a very, I think, the best possible gray area imaginable, but it creates like this interesting thought exercise of like, well, how do we really handle this?
Because it does feel like both sides have merit to where it's like, yo, like, calm down. You know, we've got all this time. And you talk about like in the NBA, things feel like they change faster than any other league. Like, all of a sudden, you could see these crazy blockbuster deals, and boom, there's some new ridiculous super team in the Western Conference, or some guys deal with injuries. Like, you know, again, talking about Thunder trauma, like when the Thunder were one of the best teams in the West, and then Russ gets hurt in the first round against the Rockets with Pat Bev, and then they end up losing the second round to the Grizzlies. That felt like it could have been maybe one of the years, and it ends up falling apart. So you never really know. You both want to take advantage of your opportunities, but don't want to go too crazy, because then you cash it too early and you maybe waste the potential you had with the core originally. It's hard in the NBA. You know, it's a balancing act. So,
and also with them too, it's like, Aaron Wiggins and Isaiah Joe aren't going to cost you nothing forever. Like after next season, we're just start talking about raises for those guys too. It's like they're just so many fascinating angles to this organization.
Yeah, we need a fundraiser because Isaiah Joe is going to ask for a lot of money.
He deserves it too. It's like no one who's listening to this podcast needs to hear it, but I don't think people understand like how hard he works defensively or what he does is like a connective path. Like he's just, if you don't watch the Thunder regularly, just watch Isaiah Joe on or off the ball. It's just so frenetically fantastic. I love it.
My brother's a Sixers fan, and every time Isaiah Joe is doing something crazy, he texts me. He's like, "Man, I can't believe we did that. Like, I can't believe we let him go."
Oh, so it's I thought you were gonna say you're texting him. That's like,
I do let him know. It's a combination. He'll like see him doing something crazy. He's like, "I can't believe we let him go." I'm like, "Yeah, man, who would ever do that? Like, that's crazy. Look how good he is in sending stats and stuff like that." So, yeah, it's back and forth. He understands they messed up.
I love it. We could go crazy and nuts with all the speculations, and it's ripe for media to kind of talk about. But I think this is a good opportunity now that, cause I think we've set the stage of like what we're thinking here as in like Thunder world as to what's going to happen. And so, kind of to wrap up and start closing up, I think one thing I want to do is maybe go around the room and, like, we've done a lot of different people. We've said a lot of different names. We've said a lot of different people, different possibilities. But if you had to pick, like, this is the one thing that the Thunder are going to do. Like, you assume they're going to make a trade, but you have to pick one and only one. What is it going to be? And so I'll maybe, if you have to think about it, I'll vamp a little bit because I don't think I realized as we were talking, I think we never mentioned the Caleb Martin stuff post me fucking up the recording. So I do want to throw out that name because I think it is interesting. He's not like the big guy we've been talking about, like the Braun and all that, but I think he's interesting because like the contract is interesting for one, but then also he's not that bad rebounding. Like he gets about 5 boards a night. He's got, like, if you watch the NBA finals last year, he's got like the ability to show up when it matters. And if you're thinking about a playoff push, like that's a guy you could slot in there. So I did want to just say like the Caleb Martin trade for me, I think is really interesting. And I won't pick it yet in case Dan, you wanted to pick that one because he was your number one on your list, but just something I wanted to shout out since I think we may have missed that in the pre-recording.
I'll just say you're beating yourself up way too much about not hitting recording.
This is going to be like a 24-hour cycle thing. And then I'm going to be like right back. I just got to, you know,
I
was interviewing Serge Ibaka once over the phone and I forgot to hit record on my recorder. So it's like, every one of us has been there. So you're beating yourself up way too much about
that. There was a time recently I recorded an hour long, like set of footage for a YouTube video. And then I went to it. And when I went to go edit, my space was almost empty on my computer. So I was like, oh, I'll just empty my recording file and emptied it and immediately deleted the thing I spent an hour recording. And I sat there for about 5 minutes and I was like, okay, I'm going to do this again. And it was a very frustrated recording.
The amount of times I've uploaded the wrong YouTube file, so it goes through the processing in HD, and it's like this 2-hour podcast.
Oh, yeah.
It's like, idiot.
Like, I did that the other day. The brother I was talking about, we do an NBA podcast, and the other day I uploaded one, and one of my friends that watches every time texts me, he's like, hey, did you upload the wrong file? Because at like the first 5 seconds, like Ryan swears like 3 times in a row. And I was like, okay, that's not what it's supposed to be. I took it down in like 30 seconds, but I was like, okay, I need to check that more thoroughly. So it happens.
I'd be a big advocate for Caleb Martin. I just wouldn't predict it. I would just say, though, he is headed. People, I think, in Heat circles wouldn't expect it either, but Miami's like not great this year. And I know they already traded a first-round pick, but if they're worried about paying Caleb Martin and they have Jaime Jaquez now, there's avenues to where the Thunder could compensate other teams to take on enough money for the Heat to get out of the tax this year. And that's something fans should not care about, but it would open the door for a Caleb Martin, who I think you laid it out is a great fit for the Thunder. And he could play the 4, like next to Chet, like him, J-Dub, Shai Gilgeous-Alexander, Chet. And then I don't care who the 5th is. J-Jo, Cason Wallace, even if you're undersized, I actually think he would help you with your rebounding. If my prediction for the Thunder would be, they're going to trade for someone in the front court who has no more than a year or two additional left on their contract. And so that would weed out Isaiah Stewart. That would weed out, I like, to Denny Avdia for this team. But like we mentioned John Collins, I think in the first iteration I mentioned maybe even a Jonathan Isaac, because they know that he can't play a lot of minutes anyway. I think that's the route they ultimately go. I mean, Robert Williams III would fit into this. He has 2 years left. And so it won't be just focused on necessarily this season. It should be someone who maybe helps them this year, but I still think they're going to focus on rolling salary slots over to keep themselves flexible for when the big splash opportunities emerge and they feel like it's the right time. I think the right time, whether it's this offseason, the 25 offseason, it will be over in offseason. And so I think that's why it'll sort of be their priority. That's how they'll rather direct themselves at this deadline.
Yeah, I think I'll piggyback a little bit on that prediction, because I also can't like pinpoint it down to like one guy. I know I said that at the beginning, but like I can't. It's too difficult to do that specifically because there's so many different possibilities. But the thing I'll predict is that I think the trade package we send out will only contain Davis Bertans and 2 first round picks. Like that's the max we're going to give up. I don't think we're going to see like any of the, like the Trey Mans or even the Pokus. I don't think they get shipped out. I think it's just Bertans for salary. And then whatever you can get value wise from that, probably front court, if we're being honest, and whatever value comes back, I think that's what it is. And it's not the most, you know, exciting thing, but like, we've been sitting here the whole time saying that's probably not what's going to happen anyway. So, I think that something along those lines is, if I had to pick a trade, that's what would happen. So, Cone, what do you think? Final prediction.
Man, I want to go crazy and say like Nick Claxton or something, because that's the guy that...
Do it for the clip.
Or go really crazy and say Cam Johnson. He won't help you with rebounding.
Mikal Bridges.
Dan.
Oh, yeah, that's the...
8 first-round picks. The Nets have... They can't turn down that one. They apparently turned down like 4
they got
and 5.
Up to 5. And so there's only like... 3 or 4 teams I can offer 5, and OKC is one of them. So.
He's one of them.
That's mind blowing to me that they got 5 first round picks. I'm like, now we're cool. We're good on that. Yeah. One of the guys that I am leaning towards predicting is Kelly Olynyk. I just think he makes sense. And this, you know, the salary's off the books next year, so it doesn't necessarily fit keeping the salary spot going forward. But I feel like we could probably re-sign him relatively cheap if that was the route we wanted to go. Not that free agents love staying in Oklahoma City necessarily. I'm going to get bold. I'm going to say Nick Claxton. Let's do it. Let's get crazy. I'm going to say Nick Claxton is the guy that we go for.
When I'm doing live grades at BR for the trade deadline, if they trade for Nick Claxton, they're going to get an A with a bunch of pluses next to it.
Okay, cool. I appreciate that.
One extra plus because Cone mentioned it on this video.
One extra plus in a line of probably 10 extra pluses for the Nick Claxton bump.
I do have to really quickly, because you mentioned Cam Johnson. I love him. I am a UNC alum, so he's like one of my favorite players of all time. Is there a world where Cam Johnson could happen with the Thunder?
Yeah, I mean, Brooklyn should first of all, Brooklyn should be listening to offers on everybody. I get that there's something weird about the Mikal Bridges to Houston makes a lot of sense, but there has to be something humbling and really crappy about we're just getting our own picks back while giving up Mikal Bridges. So I understand that, but Cam Johnson specifically, I like the idea of him on the Thunder if he could just rebound a little bit better. Otherwise, it's just sort of like, what type of highest leverage lineups is he going to be in? And his contract is fine. I just wouldn't give up as much. And he is older. Was he like 27, 28 at this point?
Yeah. He was a grad student.
If it's like 2 first round picks and Davis Bertans and like another money to make the thing work, I would do it. I have him pretty low on my board of the what I would want for the Thunder, but you bring him in and the stuff he could do, by the way, both on offense, like there's some shiftiness to him defensively. I just would like to see someone who can maybe cover bigs or at least rumble with them on the glass. And he's not that guy.
Yeah, that's fair. I just appreciate that you mentioned him because he's one of my favorites. And I wish he was on the Thunder, but he's probably not going to be. So
he's mad because our co-host Dylan is a huge Kentucky fan. We got all these Kentucky guys and there's
too many Thunder
guys over here.
We need more UNC guys, man.
You need to get more in the league first and then there could be more.
You know what? That's fine. We're working on it. We're working on it. Elliot Cadeau, he's coming up.
Okay.
So
thank you, Dan, again for hopping on the podcast. I apologize one last time. I'm going to do it. I promise I'll stop apologizing after this. I just also want to apologize to you listening, because it was only 40 minutes and it was meant to be an hour, and that was my fault. So, but thank you again for hopping on. This was a lot of fun, a lot of information, a lot of kind of stuff for the Thunder listeners to digest. And yeah, we just appreciate you coming on. Is there anything, last thing, anything you want to shout out besides, you know, we mentioned the Bleacher
Frank
Report.
Neil Kina, I think that's about it. No, that's thank good. You guys yeah. for having me. It's always a blast to come on. It was nice. I think this is the first time I recorded with you two, so it was great meeting you. Thank you for having me on. And if people like coverage beyond the Thunder and want to check out some general NBA stuff, I'm at Bleacher Report, obviously. And then I co-host the Hardwood Knox podcast, spelled exactly as it sounds. So go check that out. We do not take ourselves too seriously over there, so it's a blast.
It's always a good thing to have on a podcast. I like that. It's more free flowing that way. So thank you again, Dan. We'll sign off. Thank you all for listening. If you're watching on YouTube, please subscribe and like our channel. Comment down below who you want in the trade deadline. Is it a player? Is it a type of position? Do you want to give up Giddy or Dort? Any of those things, we'll listen and give you feedback there. If you're on a podcast, please subscribe to that podcast, wherever it is, Apple or Spotify. Thank you all for listening. God bless. Hoop when you can. And as always, Dan, this is where we all say thunder up. You can do it if you want. And as always,
thunder up.
Thunder up.
We'll take it. There we go.
Yeah.
We don't always get it.